Welcome to the Peak Performance Productivity Podcast, revealing what productive peak performers think, say, and do, so you too can be productive. With me, your host, Michael Tipper. Now, my guest today is a former ad agency creative director turned motivational speaker who recently celebrated his 26.2 years as a professional speaker by delivering 26.2 live shows lasting 26.2 minutes for 26 consecutive nights, before then running a 26.2 mile solo marathon for charity. Now, an expert in communication, his presentation coaching through his company, The Confident Club, has been described as the most powerful in the world. Not surprising from someone who has been voted European Motivational Speaker of the Year a staggering 3 times, with an impressive client list that reads like the FTSE 100. His approach, that has been described as half business guru, half stand-up comedian, regularly receives fantastic reviews, although the feedback he's most proud of was from legendary football player and World Cup winner Jack Charlton, who told him as a boy that he can't pass, but he could tackle. Now, proud of his Yorkshire roots, he once taught the topic Yorkshire in Sheffield. His no-nonsense, straight-talking and humorous approach to his work runs through every page of the latest edition of his best-selling book called How to Be a Complete Nutter Fuck-Up, 47 Half Steps to Lasting Underachievement. It's my pleasure today to welcome Steve McDermott. Steve, welcome to the show.
Hello, Michael. How are you?
So, I'm really good, thanks. It's an absolute joy to have you here. Now, what I want to do, first of all, is I want to dive into the Yorkshire part of your being. And in the spirit of your book, which we're going to talk about a lot in this interview, I'd like you to tell us all the positive Yorkshire traits that you recommend people don't adopt if they want a life of unfulfilling underachievement.
Well, I think the number one was being opinionated, really. I think that's the main trait, right? How do you know a Yorkshireman? How can you tell a Yorkshireman? Well, you can't tell him anything, really. I've got a T-shirt, actually, at home. When I say at home, I'm at home now in my office, right? Which says it's like a map of the UK, and there's like a Yorkshire's exaggerated, because Yorkshire, I don't know if you know what the biggest county is. And it was Yorkshire, right? And it's big. It's even bigger on the T-shirt. And across all here, it goes wrong. And here it says right on Yorkshire. So right. I think the thing is, what you don't want to be is always think that you're right. If you not want to be a Yorkshireman, right?
It's really interesting that the Welsh have a great identity, the Scots have a great identity, the Irish have a great identity. And the Yorkshire appears to be the only county, other than your opponents on the other side of with the different colour rows, who have the same. So those two, and I sense maybe this is my experience, that Yorkshire seems to have a stronger passion about who they are. Why is that?
Cricket, maybe. Right. So my dad, who might get mentioned in this interview, he was a massive cricket fan. And there's few of us are into Test cricket. I don't know if you like your Test cricket. You know, it's a game that can last 5 days and still be a draw. And so for me, a lot of it started with that as a little kid going to the cricket. And at that time, you could only play for Yorkshire if you were born in Yorkshire. Sure. So there's loads of stories of, you know, Michael Panks, people like driving their highly pregnant wife over the border so that they'd be born in Yorkshire to go play for Yorkshire cricket. So maybe for me, my generation, it sort of started then. If I'm honest, though, if I'm being very honest, which I like to be, there's a business aspect to this as well. And this has been confirmed just recently with some recent research. So all the call centres are in certain parts of the UK. They had an experiment where they took them to India for a while, didn't they? And that didn't quite work. And they've done the most trusted accents in the UK. In other words, people go, when I hear that accent, I trust that person. And guess what? The number one, based on research, trusted accent in the UK is?
Yorkshire.
Correct. So, you know, if you like Spinal Tap, One Foot Youngsters, I go to number 11 on Yorkshire when I'm on stage because, you know, I am honest and I do tell it like it is, as you'll know from my latest book. And it's a trait that I think most Yorkshire people have, you know, call a spade and all that. And certainly when I've got my coaching head on, when I'm coaching, you know, chief execs or people like that, they really like that kind of no-nonsense approach, you know, and there's no sort of we're not going to wrap it up in a sort of good news sandwich. This is just how it is.
Yeah. I think that honesty and that directness is really refreshing when it's delivered positively. When it's delivered with aggression, it could be quite painful.
Yeah, curmudgeonly. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. So there's two sides to that coin. You're quite right, you know, because Yorkshire people also have an unfounded reputation that we're also tight, you know.
Right.
Like that we don't bit like the Scots, you know, we don't buy the beer at the bar when they're open and all that, right? So there is two sides to it. So it can be seen as aggressive, or it can be seen as truthful or single-minded. There's a mixture, but you're right. You know, we're very proud to come from Yorkshire because it's a fantastic county.
Well, it's the second line in your book.
Yeah, yeah.
So now what runs through your book consistently, and I don't know if you've done the stats on this, but belief is mentioned 6 times in the contents, beaten only by, I think it was persistence, which has 7 references. However, the number of pages in the references are 18 pages, which outdoes the 12 pages of persistence. So belief is a massive thing in your book. So that's just an indication of just how detailed oriented I could be. So what I just want to do is we're going to dive deeper into the book and aspects of belief, but I just want to just explore the concept of belief. So fundamentally, what is a belief?
Yeah, so it's interesting. So this book, this is the third edition of this book. So I've self-published the book originally in 2001. So those people listening to this, watching this, who, if you think I've got a book in me, I want to publish a book, my top tip would be don't self-publish as a vanity project, but self-publish to kind of get your ideas down, get it together. Maybe also think of it as being a first edition, going, this can be improved upon. And that's what I did. So I self-published. And all you need to do to get a publisher really is it's about risk reversal. So it's like the publisher is just thinking, if I give you an advance, I know you've written a book and I don't know if you've got a massive advance. People think when you write a book, you get this huge advance. No, but it can be a few £1,000. And all the publishers are thinking, in my case, Pearson, is, will we get this money back? So they give you the money in advance to write it. Well, if you self-publish and as a speaker, you can say, well, I've already sold 5,000, 10,000 of these myself, right? Then that takes the risk away. So the first book was self-published in 2001. The actual real book, if you want to call it that, published by Pearson, 2002. That's a long time ago. The second edition, 2007. So it's 13 years since this book was last out. So a lot has happened in 13 years to me personally, and as we all know, in the world in general, right? But what's interesting is going right back to that self-published one, when I was thinking about this, I don't know when you were first exposed to the idea of self-development. As you say in my introduction, I used to be a creative director. And you think, the question I get asked a lot, Michael, is how the heck do you go from being a creative director? So if you followed the series Mad Men, we were like the documentary version of that, effectively. So this is advertising in the 1980s, right? So lots of partying, lots of sexism, lots of drinking, lots of creativity. Some of the best creativity, I think, in the world came out of the UK around about that time. So how did I get into this? Because I got promoted to my level of incompetence. And you probably, given your eclectic background on submarines, you know, it's like, you're good at this, now you're captain of a submarine. It's slightly different, isn't it, right? Even though you might have the rank on your shoulder. So I became a creative director, and I thought, you know, there's probably more to leadership than just being good at writing ads. So I went on various courses, and people often ask me, what's my inspiration? What's in the book? The first ever personal development course I went on, which is a classic, I don't know what it's like these days, but for many, many years, was the course that was based on Dale Carnegie's book. Now, you know Dale Carnegie's book, you know what it was called? It was originally called How to Stay Married.
Really?
But nobody's interested in that book. And we're going to talk about the power of titles and words and stuff probably during this interview. All they did was change the title to How to Win Friends and Influence People. Probably most people have heard of that book. Well, this course, this first personal development course I ever went on, was based on that book. And interestingly, I don't think they actually explicitly talked about beliefs, but the process that they put you through, basically you have to get up and present and do all sorts of stuff. You'd like this as a memory expert. One of the little things you learned with Carnegie was you'd have, this is like a 16-week course, so you'd rock up every Wednesday night and do this course. And then they had this really good model. If you were quite good, and it turned out I was quite good at this course, they'd come up to you at the end of 16 weeks and go, oh, Steve, you're quite good at this. Would you like to come back as a graduate assistant? We won't pay you in anything, but what that means is you get to do the course again and you have to be like a role model for the students. Mm-hmm. And I think this is important when we talk about productivity, Michael, because it's like you have to step up. When you're a role model, you have to like be the best that you can be, right? And one of the little exercises, which you'll know, be really familiar with, was remembering how to remember people's names. Now, I know you'll have loads of things you can give to people on how to do this, so I hope to explain how to do this. But I remember that I got selected this time. Oh, you're doing the remembering people's names as a role model this week. So this is where I'm now, I'm a graduate assistant. So what that meant was 40 people turn up at R7 at night and you've got the first session, which is about 40 minutes, to remember all their names. They've all got name badges on then. And then after the coffee break, you come out and they go, Steve is now going to demonstrate perfect recall, all take your name badges off. And he's going to tell you not only your first names, but your second names. And you'd have to go, right, Michael Tipper, John Smith, whatever. And of course, that was based on the belief that memory's got nothing to do with whether you've got a good memory or not, right? People believe that it's to do with some innate ability, or it's to do with, you know, age or brain cells. And you and I know it's actually just a strategy underpinned by a belief that if you've got the right strategy, you can do it, and a big reason why. So I support my long answer is that my interest in what was possible if you had the right beliefs around you started right back then. And if and then a bit later, and then the other thing reinforced by that was I was once doing a charity thing and one of our clients, Asda, at the Tomato Room, for any Asda people possibly watching this, at Asda House. And it was a charity thing, and I was on stage, and the second edition of the book had just come out. It was a book launch for that. And somebody said, Steve, all these steps that are in your book, and you've studied all these amazing people, if there's just one thing you could pick that's the most important thing of all, what is it? And my answer was, it's when I discovered that beliefs aren't true. Mm. Right. And I went on my first Carnegie course in 1990, right? So I can't do the maths of what, how old I am now. But, you know, I was quite old to just have even thought of that. And I think most people listening to this, if there's one thing to take away from this, it would be, when was the last time you stepped back and analysed what your beliefs are and whether they're true or not, and how they're making you behave, right? And I realized I had a lot of beliefs, what some people might call them unhelpful or disempowering or whatever. And so my definition of a belief is, it's just something you feel certain about based on some references, or if you like, experiences you've had so far that you've picked up off, sometimes from your parents or from the environment. And I think a great way to think about it, if you think of it as a metaphor, if you think of a belief being like a table, so the tabletop is whatever the belief is, and the legs of the table are the references that give you that solid feeling that it's true, that conviction. Now, sometimes you get the tabletop first, and sometimes you get the legs afterwards, and we can go into that as we go through. So all the belief is something you feel certain about based on some reference you've had so far, and memory is just one example of that.
It's interesting, why not, the belief issue around memory. So when I entered the World Championships and came second, I came second because I believed I would come second, but I didn't believe I could win it. I'd set the goal for second, and I was driven by belief. And there was a time when I talked about beliefs along those lines. So beliefs do really affect us. Now, the motivation for the book came from a survey that was done, I think you said it was 2001, where it's only 25 or 10% of people would rather be dead. 25% of people were couldn't see any future, and 33% of people was just generally miserable. What about that just drove you to write the book? Was it a belief issue?
Yeah, well, I think part of it is. So I found out early on in my motivational speaker career. So think about this again, right? So you go, right, so hang on a minute. So you're a creative director, and then you did this personal development course, and then I was applying those ideas at work. How did you shift from that to being a motivational speaker? And what happened was, I thought a lot of these ideas are really good, so I was naturally taking them back and delivering them to my team, and so it like became a bit of a hobby. And then a guy left Carnegie and he said, you should come and work for me, right? Which was like sort of saying, you know, if your hobby was golf, you should play golf for a living. I thought, oh, no, I don't need to come and work for you, but I could work for me. So I left the agency, longer story, and I started my own training company, right? And then started doing workshops, and time and time again, people would go, this stuff, do you, you know, is it, it's all bespoke, isn't it, Steve? And I went, yeah. So you don't have a course that people can go on then? I went, no. And I kept telling people, you know, sometimes people have needs, but you need to give them what they want. And eventually I thought, do you know, so many people said, don't we have a course you could go on? So I designed a course, which you came on many, many years ago. And I thought, I'm going to do a course. I'm just going to put in it all the things I've learned about personal development and business development and self-development that I've been using with me. Because again, the other thing, people from Yorkshire, is I only want to do it if it works.
Yeah. Right?
So I did all that and eventually did a massive thing at the Royal Armouries. And just before that, somebody said, you should invite this guy called Brendan Barnes, who happened to be an agent from London. And he said, can I be your agent? I'm going, what's that about? He went, yeah, as a speaker, I just get all these bookings. You just turn up, shout your mouth off for 45 minutes and there you go. So suddenly I find myself as a motivational speaker, right? Which is when I found my real purpose, I suppose. So I still do the training, but I do the motivational speaker bit. And I realised, having read a lot of these books and stuff, you know, I'm a massive fan, for example, of, I mentioned Carnegie, a lot of these ideas were particularly coming out of North America. And I think one of the most famous people for that, I won't name him, but he's really tall. He's a really tall American motivational speaker.
6'8".
Really nice, with really nice teeth. I'm not mentioning him. I know you're a massive fan of him, Michael, and I am, right? But God love him. He don't understand British sense of humour, really. And he don't understand that a lot of Brits aren't that comfortable massaging each other at a massive event. You know, let's all dance and massage each other. Now, you and I are prepared to do that to get the ideas, aren't we? You know, I put myself through that kind of quite American discomfort, you know, just say yes and all that, right? And I thought there might be a different way. Could we use humour? Could we actually use Yorkshire humour to get these ideas out to a wider audience, especially outside of America? And that's where this kind of combining humour with practical stuff. So my goal has always been to get under people's radar by using a bit of humour when they're giving them some powerful ideas, which if you've just presented it to them straight, they might just dismiss it. Because I think there's two types of people. There's people like me and you, and maybe people that are fans of your podcast and stuff, that are voracious readers and learners, and they'll just find information to be more productive, more efficient, more successful, more happy, more fulfilled, wherever they can find it, whatever language and whatever accent it's in. But there's this other great mass of people who've never been exposed to personal development, and you need to make it palatable for them. And I think sometimes you have to like fool them a little bit. So a lot of people buy my books and sometimes book me because they think they're getting a comedian or they think they're getting a funny book, which they are to some degree. But what's actually in there, some powerful ideas. And how I know they're powerful is I've been using them for over 30 years. And I'm never going to recommend anything to anybody that didn't work for me or people that I've worked with.
I think one thing I think I found about the book, I'd not read it before. I'd seen it in the past and I always admired the title. But then you were very kind enough to give me an advanced copy, which is green, by the way, not blue because of my...
Hey, well, there we go. That's what you
that's
really
the one. Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah, yeah. That's green for you.
And I was impressed by the freshness. I think the reverse psychology approach to it, because you're going down the route of saying, "Don't do this if you want to if you want a fulfilling life, then don't set goals, don't do this." And I think it's just absolute genius. And this issue of belief does run through it. And you described it as a tabletop with legs.
Yes.
Could you just explore? Give us an impact of how beliefs can affect our lives before we maybe explore where they come from, what we can do about them.
Well, let's use the metaphor again. And again, you know, I think if we can make it simple, I think when you talk about, you know, often when I discount, because I use beliefs when I'm doing presentation mastery, because I think it's really important about presenting as well. You know, so people are very fearful of doing what we're doing now, for example. And so we think about, sometimes you get the tabletop from a generalization, right? And then if you say it's true, you just get one leg on your table. So you have this one intense emotional experience, right? So you say you have a really intense emotional experience and you go, all men are horrible, right? Because I have this one intense experience with this one guy. And then you say it's true of everybody. So sometimes you build a belief like that and you act in accordance with that belief. Or sometimes somebody tells you something and you accept it as being true, right? So it's kind of like confirmation biased, I think, is the scientific way of looking at this, right? So you've already been told something that you buy into. So, for example, we used to live the other side of Leeds, and the next door neighbours were moving. And that's always a worry, isn't it? Because you think, who's going to move in? And my wife, Candy, had met the existing neighbours and said, oh, no, the people that are moving in are really nice. And they've got a little daughter who's like was the same age as my daughter, Megan, at the time, was about four. But the existing neighbours kind of looked round and they went, but you know, this little girl that's moving in, she's really, really spoiled. She's really precocious. So I got home from work one day and Candy said, oh, neighbours have moved. I've been having a coffee with Mum and their daughter's been playing in the garden all afternoon without Megan. And then Candy even went, but I tell you what, they were right. She's very spoiled. She's very precocious. Now, I wonder, because you'd already been got that tabletop, you only could see what you look for. So as a speaker, you'll know this, Michael, sometimes you want to get a brief about an audience, but if somebody tells you this audience is going to be really difficult, you look for the references, you look for the legs to prove that they were right, you know. It's called the Pygmalion effect, isn't it, right? So it's kind of, so that's one way you get a belief, right? But the other way is culturally. So I think, you know, if you think about Christmas time, right? So I think the simplest one we can all relate to, whether your belief is in Father Christmas or not, I think we can all relate to this belief. So think about it. Do you come out of the womb with your beliefs already hardwired in? No. So when you're a very small child, you're like a sponge baby, aren't you, right? You know, when you're 3, 4, 5, your mum and dad are going, if you behave, now notice the point here is the belief drives the behaviour. If you behave, Father Christmas, you know, which list are you on? Not you're nice, right? If you behave, have you written your letter? So all these behaviours come out of the belief of Father. Have you written your letter to Santa Claus yet? Have you put your stocking up, right? So massive impact on what you believe right now were or are your parents, which is why it's such a big responsibility if you have kids or if you're an uncle or an auntie or whatever, right? And again, being from Yorkshire, I think most of the beliefs, I was really aware of this with my kids as we were growing up. Most of the beliefs we give our kids, I think, quite often are to keep them safe, which is fair enough, or to stop them being disappointed. Now, if this podcast is talking about being more productive and more happy and more successful, you know, so it's a bit like the guy in Doncaster, right, which is a north part of in Yorkshire, and his son coming up to me in a really excited state going, dad, I want to be an astronaut. And his dad's saying, don't be stupid, son, you come from Doncaster, right? So we get that first reference to our table, don't we, from mum and dad, right? Then as we grow up, who else kicks in is a more important, maybe a louder noise, is our peer group. Now, again, back to the tabletop being Father Christmas. So one leg is mum and dad. Next leg is when you're little, really excited. Oh, what are you getting for Father Christmas? What are you getting Christmas Day? So we've already got quite a strong belief in Father Christmas now. Next key influencer on our beliefs as we grow up are our teachers in the broadest sense, right? So again, teachers are saying, children, if you behave, so remember beliefs drive behavior, we might have a special guest coming all the way from the North Pole, you know, on Friday to school. And then of course, magically, certainly in Yorkshire, you come down Christmas morning and there's some presents. So we now 100% believe in Father Christmas. And then most of us change that belief in a heartbeat. And it normally starts now with your peer group, doesn't it? Normally starts when you get a bit older, your peer group are going, you know it's your mum and dad, don't you? You know it's your mum and dad. There's like a wobbly leg on your table, isn't it? You confront your mum and dad. Is it you? Yeah, it is. There's another wobbly leg. You confront your teachers. Are you in on this worldwide conspiracy? Yes, children, it's the only time we ever lie to you, right? And now, like a month before Christmas, there's toy catalogue, there's the Argus catalogue. Pick something. So the point being is you can create and change beliefs in a heartbeat. Father Christmas is just one example, but it works like this. What happens when I discuss beliefs in my book, or when I discuss beliefs on stage and all the rest of it, and in workshops, is people want me to prove to them that the belief's true. And I think the important thing to take away from beliefs is it's not relevant whether the belief's true. What's more important is how that belief makes you behave. How that belief makes you behave, right? So, for example, another example we can all relate to is when people believed, which the vast majority of people did, that the world was flat, it didn't half limit travel, didn't it? Because it's like, we're not going to go anywhere because we might fall off the end, right? So I'd start to think, what do I believe about my abilities? Is it true? Do I choose to believe it's not true? How is it making me behave? And how, what I believe moment to moment, day to day, week to week, month to month, that affects my outcome, my results at the end, right? So as another example, when I used to believe I was terrible at maths, at arithmetic. Now, would you, rhetorical question, Michael, would you like to guess why I believed I was bad at maths? It's a rhetorical question, because my math teacher told me all the time that I was, and to this day, I still never passed what was my O level, what you would now call GCSE maths, never. But I think it wasn't because I didn't have the ability to do it. I had a profound deep belief that I couldn't do it, because I get being told that I couldn't, right? Cut to when I start my own business, and suddenly, you know, when you've got your limited company, all the rest of it, VAT, tax, I actually stood back, and one of the questions you can ask yourself is, how useful is it for me to continue to believe that I'm bad at something? Because one way to create change is a lot of pain, isn't it? Another way is to have a big reason why. So I had a sort of towards, which is, wouldn't it be wonderful if I chose, because you get to choose, right, to believe that I can be good at maths? You know, maths where it's appropriate, practical, I can use it. And if I don't adopt that belief, there's going to be a lot of pain attached, not better doing my VAT returns, right? And turned out I was pretty good at maths, and I could learn to be good at maths, right? But I bought that belief from a teacher. So examine, where do you get your beliefs from, right? No, trust me, nobody comes out the womb terrified of speaking in public.
Yeah.
But most people believe that you have to, like, you know, you're either born with the gift of the gab or you're not, or you're born with a great memory. So these are all beliefs we buy into on an unconscious level, and we never challenge them for most of our lives, if not all our lives.
One of the things that I think was really powerful about watching the videos of you doing your presentation training, so you don't do presentation training, you do presentation beliefs training.
Yeah.
And then your idea that beliefs come first, skills come second. Now, one of the things you talked about there was this, the issue of choosing your beliefs and choosing whether to change them. And I know we're going to talk more in detail about your fitness, but you talk in your book about how you chose not to buy into the belief that when you were going to run a marathon that you wouldn't hit the wall, or that you would hit the wall. You chose not to do that. Just talk through how you had the wherewithal to realize that actually it was a choice you could make, and what you did to go through that.
Well, again, I think the thing is, because I remember, so even though I was quite sort of long in the tooth when I had the realization that you got what beliefs were and that where they came from, and that you had a choice, right? So that's still 30 years ago. So for 30 years, I've had the realization that we get to choose and we get to decide where they come from. So it struck me that if I was going to train for and indeed run, and I've now run two marathons, but my first ever marathon was last year, the Yorkshire Marathon, unsurprisingly, right? And I was 62 when I did that, right? And I thought, would it be useful to believe that you're going to hit this thing called the wall? Now, the thing is, beliefs always underpin skills, and skill, you need to know the skills, and you need a lot of knowledge to get these different legs for your table. So I had a lot of knowledge around running by this time in terms of nutrition, fitness, training, all the rest of it, right? Rest, exercise and stuff. But I thought, it's interesting, isn't it? Because when you look at, there's two beliefs here. Some people hit the wall and some people don't. Well, what are the people who don't hit the wall doing differently to the ones who do? And I figured out there was like some research and some science on it that I could test in my training. But it fundamentally just started with, it doesn't have to exist. It doesn't exist for a lot of people. And it also went with the belief that you don't have to look like you're a miserable bugger when you're running a marathon. Because I'd noticed in training, and I'd noticed in shorter races. So the first race, I did three races in a year, right? So I moved up each time. So I did like a 10K, and then I did a half marathon, then I did a full marathon. And in all these races, I noticed, just, I would say 95% of people look miserable. And I just couldn't get my head around that, because I thought, well, you've done 4 months of training to get to the start line. Why would you not have a massive smile on your face? You know, you've done the hard work. It doesn't. So I think it's beyond just believing you'd hit the wall. It's like, it doesn't have to be a terrible experience. Kevin Sinfield, who's an absolute hero to me as we speak right now, has just completed 7 marathons in 7 days.
Wow.
Right? Because he had a massive reason why, because he's running on behalf of Rob Burrow, and most people are aware of the condition Rob Burrow's got, right? But he had a massive reason why to do that. So the big reason why helped him with that. But trust me, he also decided it was possible and he tested it. Because I think what helps you believe, one reference was, I tested this, that this is possible. Right. So he was going to run 7 marathons. So to test that, he ran 3 over 3 days. And that gave him the belief that he could do 7 over 7 days, right? So in my training, I was testing that, testing my nutrition, testing I won't get cramp and stuff. And there's a reason, there's a scientific reason, proven reason why people hit the wall. But the thing is, if you go into a marathon believing you're going to hit the wall, guess what you're going to do? You're probably going to hit the wall because you're going to be looking for, because just like that little girl where we told she was spoiled, we're looking for evidence to prove it's true. When you get to 18, 19 miles in a marathon, if you believe there's a good chance you could hit the wall, you're going to start to notice things. Because it's a filter, like, oh, hang on, what's going on there? You know, I feel a little bit tired. I feel a bit more tired than I should do. Whereas if you've decided, no, I've trained right, I've done the nutrition, I've done all the rest of it, you'd interpret that particular message, whether it's a physical thing or a mental thought, in a totally different way. So I think the other thing is, if you've got different beliefs, we can have been in the same room with the same people and have a totally different experience, because we have totally different beliefs. And so people are experiencing the world in a completely different way. So when we talk, you say, I don't do presentation skills training. No, I do presentation beliefs installing, if you like. And we give people a set of beliefs to help them, which means when they have an experience presenting, they interpret that experience in a different way. I've had some, I don't know what some, you must have had some amazing, incredible experiences on stage. I mean, some of the stuff that's happened to me, I mean, I want, as an example, I once turned up, right, at an event, and I'm looking for the MD of the company, and they went, oh, he's in this room, right? And I went in, and you know when you go in a room and there's like an atmosphere, like nobody's spoken, but you know something terrible's happened, right? And there's a group of people, and I went up to them and I said, I can see you having a private meeting, but I thought I'd just let you know that I'm here. I'm Steve McDermott, the guest speaker, because I'm always concerned as the speaker turned up out of the micro, right? And this guy just went, bloody hell, we forgot about you. Can you wait outside? I'll be with you in a minute. I went, okay. So a couple minutes later, he comes outside and he goes, there's no other way of putting this. We've just found out we've gone bust.
Oh.
Right? And we've got 500 customers out there and they don't know either. And so I don't know if we'll be wanting the funny motivational speaker after lunch. Do you know what I mean? Can he come back later? But because I have a set of beliefs, you know, that didn't throw me. Just didn't throw me at all, right? Because beliefs, the other thing, there's some fundamental things that impact on how you feel. And one of the key things that impacts on your feel, how you feel, is your beliefs. Beliefs really impact on your feelings. So, you know, for example, if you believe things are permanent, that's going to put you in a very different state if you as if you believe all things must pass, all things will change. It's a totally different beliefs.
So just come on that one about the permanence. One of the things that I think challenges a lot of people is that they are stuck in their world that might be that my beliefs are permanent. Now, you know, I know that we can change them, but that person who's locked into that world. So let's give you an example. I mean, you talked about the flat earth. Okay, there are still flat earthers today who are convinced the world is flat. They are locked into that. Now, I think that's a choice they can make. But what if someone is so constrained by beliefs that their current beliefs don't allow them to even consider the possibility of there being a change, whether they can be more productive or be more fit or overcome depression? We're going to talk about that, I know. So how do people deal with that?
It's hard. It's hard because I think, you know, until you've got that insight. And that's why I'm so passionate about the work I do, and I know you are. And like my book, I'm thinking, well, you know, if somebody picks up my book thinking, oh, this will be a bit of a fun read, and then they suddenly get an insight, because ironically, it's kind of like a contradiction in terms. Most people believe that they don't have a choice what they believe, right? Yeah. So for most people, some people, because of your fans, might not be the people listening to this, but a lot of people going, I don't have a choice, right? I don't have a choice what I believe. I can't change what I believe. So I think to answer your question, it's a challenge, because until you get that insight that you have a choice, now then if you, when people arrive at one of our workshops, that most of them arrive with these beliefs around, well, I have a lousy memory, you know, I'm lacking confidence, I can't do this, I can't tell a good story, I can't do the other. And what we do is give them an experience. So I think what can fundamentally change your beliefs is if you have an experience. If you have an experience that changes beliefs. So again, not now, but you know that one of my party tricks was teaching people. I'm a big fan of NLP because I think NLP is great at doing a lot of work around beliefs. And NLP, you know, if you asked 1,000 master practitioners of NLP what it is, you get 1,000 different answers. But if you ask me, it would be NLP believes that everything's a strategy. And have you noticed some people have better strategies than others, like getting to work on time is a strategy, falling in love is a strategy, staying in love is a strategy. So what NLP does is you can model somebody that's great at what they do, figure out the strategy, teach it to somebody else. Don't mean they can be as good as the person, but it doesn't have rapidly back to productivity, increase the results at a faster rate. So we've modeled lots of great communicators and these fundamental beliefs. But what we do is we put people through an experience. So I think what you can do is search out information. First of all, you need to have the insight that you need to analyze and look at what your beliefs might be. Yeah. They may be on an unconscious level. But sometimes if you want to know what your beliefs are, listen to the excuses that come out of your mouth all the time is what I would say. A good place to start is language. So NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. So notice when you say to people, or if you want to know what other people's limiting beliefs are, listen carefully and you'll hear language like this, if only. So people go, if only that had been a pandemic. If only I wasn't lousy at maths. If only my dad wasn't an alcoholic. If only I was older. If only I was younger. If only I had more money. If only I wanted in this sales area, right? And what that's saying is this is a limit that they're putting themselves. Or the other one is people often say things like, I wish. I wish this, I wish that, which is kind of going, I have no control over making a change there. So if only I wish are all the indicators of that you might have to put some limits on what might be possible for you. A lot of people use this language when we first give them a challenge on our workshops. They'll say, I can't. And I can't is often a good way of noticing if you might have got a limit on something that you think's possible. You probably have had this a lot when you're teaching people lots of stuff about productivity. And let's take memory again. And you say to them, I can teach you a way of remembering, I don't know, all the planets in their order from the sun, or remembering these 40 different things, or the example I gave earlier, these 50 different names. I can, and they'll often go, I can't. They'll immediately say to your face, even though you could prove to them as a world memory champion that it's possible, they'll still say to your face, I can't. So you have to give them an experience to prove they can, don't you? So I think sometimes you have to put yourself in environments where you prove to yourself what's possible, you know. So in my case, I didn't go out and run a marathon right straight off the bat. That would have been insane. But what happens is your belief increases with experiences. So when I was talking about the book, you know, because the first book was self-published, here it is, right? Like a little thin thing that I self-published. But that people like that. And I thought, oh, I can write. Now, I already had a belief that I was quite a good writer because I was a copywriter by trade, right? So that did well. That gave me the confidence that I could sell it to peers. And so second edition came out and I went, oh, that's okay. And so on and so forth. So if you've never written a book before, you may think, oh, that's awesome, ridiculous, I could never do it. But once you've written one, your belief that you can write another one just comes down. So I think what happens with beliefs is once you do it incrementally. So I think the other thing with productivity, it's not that you have to go do something amazing, something incredible. You know, if you want to run a marathon, don't train and run for a marathon for your first ever race. Do what I did, which was I got into running because my wife, Candy, and guess what she did? Couch to 5K. And I think Couch to 5K, which is a wonderful app, is a brilliant way of how beliefs can work, because it shows you that no matter how old you are, no matter what pretty much physical conditioning, you can go from being literally, you know, a couch potato to running 3.2 miles in whatever it is, 2 months, 3 months, right? And once you realize that, you think, well, actually only twice 5K is 10K. And that's all I did. So I did Couch to 5K, then I did, you know, 10K. And I thought, well, 10 twice 10K is half a marathon. Did half a marathon. Well, twice half a marathon is a marathon. So my belief, my self-belief went up in steps each time. So I think that's the way to do it. Identify, notice what you say, notice what your limiting beliefs might be. You might need somebody else, like a coach, like yourself, to point out to you, do you know, I think that's a limit you've put on yourself, what's possible. Another way to break a belief is if you think there's something you want to achieve, but you believe you can't do it, just find somebody else who has, is the simplest way. Now, because of what's happened, you know, with social media, with the internet, right, it's so easy to find these great role models. So, you know, if you think, I can't do that, I can't do that because I'm this age. Well, just find one other person that has done it that's your age, and then it's no longer true. What if you can find 10 people that's done it? What if you can find 100, right? What if you can, so same if you're starting a business, whatever you're doing, find that role model and go, well, what did they do? Because clearly it's not true because they did it.
You know, you took up running 26.2 miles at quite a senior age.
Yeah.
Now, did you encounter any limiting beliefs that you recognised as limiting beliefs that you felt that you had to deal with using these approaches? Or did you just naturally think, no, I'm going to do this and that's how it went?
I think if you've been exposed, this is what's so exciting. I think the sooner you're exposed to these ideas, the better. So another one that we've not touched on, I think, you know, when you talk about beliefs, I think there's, so what's interesting is I feature a few beliefs, but the number one belief I would recommend you consider. So here's the thing, if you never thought about this, if you just one belief you want to consider, if you've not been conscious of it in your life so far, it's this. It's critical if you are going to be happy. And I would take the word happy as being my favorite word, but you could use the word fulfilled. You could use the word successful. You could use the word peak performer, productive life, whatever. It's critical that you make yourself accountable and responsible for everything, because I've modeled loads of people and I've applied it in my own life and business. And the one belief that all, and I mean all, happy, successful, productive people share is that they make themselves accountable and responsible for their results, like for everything, right? Now, how do you know that most people don't do that and most young people are aware of that? Well, I've got three grown-up children now and two have moved back in and moved back out again. But when they were at this wonderful thing, so they're all roughly 2 years apart, right? I recommend that as a strategy as well, really, because then when they get to certain age, they can all look after each other. But at this wonderful experience where oldest lad, Tom, was doing his A-levels and my middle son, Finley, was doing his GCSEs. And unlike you and me who are a certain age, they have this thing now called study leave. Do you know about this, Michael?
Yeah,
study
I've heard leave. Of that, yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know where, I think it's like 3 weeks where they're meant to go home and revise and they need people like you to help them, I would suggest. But anyway, so they might be doing a bit of mind mapping, whatever, and all that. So my two are doing study leave at the same time because they're doing an exam at the same time. And I thought, oh, I'll leave them to it. I've taught them a few things, as I say, mind mapping, whatever. And I left them to it, and it seemed to just consist of them lying on the sofa watching, when it was on at the time, Jeremy Kyle, you know, daytime TV. So I thought, I better sort of say to them, boys, you know, study leave. How do you think you, by the way, how do you think you're both going to do any exams? And they both went, terrible, crap, going to be rubbish. I went, really? Why is that? And they said, because our teachers are rubbish. Because our teachers are rubbish. Now, I think that's a really good example. So the reality, this back to beliefs don't have to be true, but how do they make you behave? The reality might be that both of their teachers in their year groups might have not been particularly good teachers, or they might have been good teachers, but it kind of don't matter because they've given up all the responsibility to the teacher rather than themselves. Their behaviour will be, well, it's not to do with me, right? Mm. So what most people, because I've asked this question for the research for the book and on stage and whatever, and I ask audiences this question a lot. I said to people, how many people here and how many people listening to this believe they are 100% accountable and responsible for everything, right? And only a small number, I would say it's about 10% of people, if that, put their hands up to that and go, yeah. And when I say 100% accountable, responsible, I mean, for what you do, what you have, who you're with, what you earn, like everything, right? How you feel. And then I'll often, you know, when people say this to you, somebody puts it on and go, yeah, I believe I'm 100% accountable, responsible. And I always go to them in the audience and say, I don't want you to take this the wrong way. I don't want you to be offended. You know, when people say that and then they say something really offended, right? So let's say, Michael, you put your hand up to that because I know you believe this too, right? Oh, so Michael, you believe you're 100% accountable, responsible. Michael, I don't want you to take this the wrong way. Are you crazy? Are you insane? Is the straitjacket, you know, just below your feet there? Because it seems when you first exposed to it, a crazy belief. How can you possibly believe as an individual you are 100% accountable, responsible, right? So let's take a slightly different belief. This is what most people believe. They go, oh, no, I can believe this, so Steve. 20% luck, circumstances, accident of birth, right place, right time. 80% down to me. That's what most people listening to this would say. Yeah, that's how the world is, right? Now, there's some people, hopefully, again, nobody watching or listening to this, who believe that it's 100% nothing to do with them, right? So we can ignore those people for now. So let's take the 20-80 people, right? So this thing about it don't have to be true. Why would you choose to move the numbers? Well, the most profound example I got of this was I got a call from Hull. This is Hull, H-U-L-L, Hull, the Insular Peninsula, as I like to call it. One road in, one road out, right? And Hull Council said, Steve, we hear about this stuff you do, you know, and we've spent a lot of money on the environment, but maybe it's more to do what's going on between people's ears. And because you're from Yorkshire and all that, will you come and talk to this housing association, the residents, about how they can improve their lives? And I'm like, I'd love to do that, right? So I turn up on this quite sort of challenging council estate, like every other house is boarding up or whatever. And I'm in the room with the residents and I'm talking about this belief and I'm saying to them, there's about 100 of them, how many people in this room believe they're 100% accountable and responsible, like for everything? Well, of course, they looked at me like I was mad, didn't they? Like, what, for where we, for our circumstances, for this, are you insane, right? Right, okay. How many people think it's 20-80, you know, 20% circumstances, accident of birth, looks, all that stuff, and 80% down you, which is what most people listening to this or watching this will put their hand up to. No. Now, nobody said it was 100% nothing to do with them because they probably wouldn't have come to the meeting, right? But interestingly, in that particular group, in that particular environment, they said it was 80% circumstances, 80% wow. Circumstances, wow. Look, accident, and 20% down to them. Here's the point. If their ambition was to improve their lives, to maybe move off that quite challenging, that challenging environment, that run-down housing estate, till they change the numbers in the head, they never will, because they've got 80% of stuff they can blame. So this is my point about it. It's not whether it's true. It's if you choose to make yourself 100% accountable, responsible, first of all, you can take credit for it all, but you don't have things you can blame. And I think this is really relevant in the challenging times we find ourselves in. Because if we're not careful, we'll find lots of things we can blame. And it stops us being proactive. And I think one of the key characteristics of peak performers and people who are productive is that they're proactive. Mm. Would you agree?
Oh, definitely. Now, one of the things I want to explore is this concept of when you're in a situation where... it feels like you have no control. So in your book, you talk about depression.
Yes.
The only one of your recommendations that is phrased positively. So you say, believe that you can overcome depression. Yeah. And in there, there's talk about, and you refer to your own experiences of, and Candy writes her description of how she described it. But there's this issue about, when you're lying in bed and you're crying and you believe you can't you can't ever be fixed or well again, in those circumstances, share with us your experience around beliefs.
Let's touch on it. I said we could do a whole podcast, maybe we should another time, on the whole topic of mental wellness. And I prefer to talk about mental wellness rather than mental ill health, because I think we should all be thinking about being mentally well, just like we think about being physically well, whether we're ill or not, right? Just as you would do with your physical health. I think there's a belief that sits at the heart of mental illness, and particularly in my case, depression, and it's this. You know, because it's quite funny when you... you can only laugh at it with the value of hindsight, by the way, you know. An unmotivated motivational speaker, get your head around that, right? Imagine how that is, right? But that's how where I found myself. And here's the belief I had back then. And this is, again, if you want to take anything away from this in terms of a piece of information to give you a better understanding about mental ill health and in particular depression, it's this. I used to have the belief that you had a choice. That's my key message around mental health and particularly depression, because I used to, you know, being simplistic and using a cliche, are you a glass half or are you a glass half empty type person? Glass half full, glass half empty. And of course, I would have described myself, because I'm a motivational speaker and I'm into all this stuff for, you know, 20 odd years, whatever, as definitely a half glass full type person, right? And we know that most people also have this belief that you have a choice, you know, whether your glasses are full or half empty, because there's a paper in the UK, I'm not going to name it, but it's one of the, it's not particularly one of my favourite papers, Daily Mail. And anyway, in there they have a survey and they ask, you know, often famous people, they ask them things like, can you still run up a flight of stairs? And one of the questions they always ask them is, have you ever had depression? And I would say, again, 99% of people answer that and go, no, because I'm a mentally strong person. Mm. And what that tells me is people have the belief that you have a choice, right? And what I discovered was that, no, you don't have a choice whether your glass is half empty or half full when you get mental illness. And the other thing I discovered in terms of misunderstanding is that mental ill health, because it's been not studied as much as maybe physical health, is misunderstood and not particularly well understood either. So, you know, people often when I... and I think it's important that men in particular talk about the mental health. So I'm a bit of an advocate for this. I'm not big on talking about my own depression. Who wants to talk about that? But what might be some ways to stay well? But people always say to me, oh, what caused it? And particularly men want to find the cause, don't they? Want to find a solution to everything, right? What was good? And I've got to tell you, I've still no really idea what caused it. You know, there's even doctors can't agree what causes a lot of mental health and depression. So some people say it's a chemical imbalance in the brain. Some people say it's a lot particularly challenging life circumstances, you know, relationships, money, whatever, job loss. Some people say it's an injury. You know, I broke my ribs. In my case, I broke my ribs and you get into like inflammation, all sorts of stuff. Don't know, right? What I do know is in terms of the power of beliefs, with something like mental health, it's a real challenge. It's a real challenge. And you need to, everybody presents differently. And I can't give wholesale generalized advice to everyone. But what I can say is that you will find in at some point a way and a strategy that just like couch to 5K, then 10K, half marathon, marathon, just with depression, I think, or with anything, it's those baby steps. So I think to build a rock solid belief. So in my case, it was when Candy said, just do one thing. So this really ties into your productivity message. So, and it might be just a routine thing. So what most people, if anybody listening to this has had the challenge of mental ill health or depression, they'll be able to relate to this. It's really hard to do anything sometimes. So it's sometimes hard just to clean your teeth, right? Never mind, get out of bed. However, beliefs, powerful beliefs can come from really small, tiny little productive things.
Yeah.
And you'll know this, doing that one thing, doing that one task. And I know you're really big on this, Michael. So for me, it was just committing to doing the ironing. Just doing the ironing every day. That was my one commitment to Candy and having somebody I had to be accountable to, right? Regardless how I was feeling mentally, I would get out of bed or whatever my state was and I would do the ironing. And that's how I started. So for every day, and it started with just 5 minutes of ironing and like, I'm done now. And then 10 minutes of ironing. And then 20 minutes. Unfortunately, that was more than 20 minutes of ironing. I was doing it longer than that, right? So that was the little thing that changed my belief around, right? So I think it's a complex issue. I don't think beliefs on their own are the solution when it comes to mental health. But I think it starts with us all having a better understanding and stopping believing that we have a choice. Because trust me, one in four people, and perhaps even more now, actually, will have some mental ill health challenges, whether that's depression, anxiety, something else. And I think it starts with helping people. I think maybe the other message we'll give to this is, let's change the belief that it's a stigma. That's the other thing. I think in a society way. So you're talking about individual beliefs. Maybe the better way to approach this is to, do you know what? If we all had different legs on the table, which said, do you know what? You're not less of a man if you've had a mental health issue. You know, it's not about I have to be strong all the time. So I would say maybe society needs to change its beliefs first before individuals can feel more comfortable to discuss these issues.
You're right. We could do a whole episode on mental wellness. And I think the important message for me that comes out of that is that if you find yourself in that situation, the belief to hold is that it's possible to get out. It doesn't matter what your beliefs are that got you there. It doesn't matter how you got there. When you're there, I think, and you have proven that it is possible. And it is something as simple as just getting out of bed or just doing something like going and cleaning your teeth as a starting point. It's that thin edge of the wedge that will then allow you to move forward. I think that's the key thing to take away from that.
Yeah, I think it is. And I think we have a lot of beliefs around, again, back to the stigma bit and the misunderstanding, is we believe that other people won't understand. I think that's the other thing, right? So as well as that, I think the hardest thing to do, here's the other thing I would say to it on this particular topic is, the hardest thing to do is to tell people. That's the hardest thing to do. So that's the other thing, obviously, I would recommend anybody does, is that they tell people that they're suffering in some way, whatever that is, right? Somebody they trust. The challenge, though, is it's easy. It's good to tell people, but it's hard to talk. That's the absolute dilemma with, I think, particularly depression and other forms of mental ill health, because you maybe get to the point where I know to encourage myself, believe to help me get out of this. What's going to help me is to have the support of others. I need to tell people. Often you can't find the words, right? Mm. So I think my other little sort of as little side thing that as a productivity note, as it were, would be just find, I think what's a really powerful, useful tip is find a different way to communicate. So, you know, my natural, as you probably don't notice, is talking. I ironically couldn't do that. You might think, thank God, when I was depressed, right? But what I found really useful was like a WhatsApp group with my really good male friends that I've known for 40 years. So I could communicate on WhatsApp, or in Candy's case, it might be a little text or even a letter, right? So that you can start that debate. So yes, little steps, little baby steps, but also have the belief that people will understand. And when you start to tell people and you find the ways to tell them, whatever that might be, whether that's speaking or writing, you will be amazed how many people go, been there, had that, know that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think it's a bit of a bandwagon. Unfortunately, I think, you know, it's all right having, you know, ITV celebrities going, it's good to talk. Yeah, that's all well and good, right? But I think... I've actually got another book coming out. Well, I haven't written another book, but I've written a chapter in a book called Being Fine, and it's 20 blokes that have written their experiences about dealing with mental challenges and mental ill health, right? And that's been all the profits from that are going to a brilliant charity called My Black Dog. Right. So again, that's My Black Dog. And what I love about that is it's manned by people who have actually had experiences with mental ill health themselves. So I think, you know, sympathy is not much good, but empathy is spot on. So, you know, find the right people to talk to is what I would say about that. And that can change your beliefs that it is possible to get better because they did.
I think that's a powerful note to end the interview. I would love to spend more time exploring you giving up alcohol and the beliefs around that, but maybe we can do that another time. So you've given us so many things about beliefs, so many insights, so many recommendations. If you were to be pushed for the one thing that you would say to people about their beliefs, what would that one recommendation be as a starting point or as an idea? What would that be?
I think it would be think about something that's going to make you really happy or fulfilled or a goal. And I would make that not a thing you want to have. I'm not big on having goals to do with stuff like houses, cars and all that, but the sort of person you'd like to become, right? So in my case, it might be, you know, I'd like to be fit. I'd like to be fitter. or I'd like to drink less, or I'd like to be a better mum or dad or a better partner, right? So identify one area of your life that you'd like to be more fulfilled and happy in, and then identify a belief that might be stopping you doing that. What is it that's stopping you doing that? And then go searching. There's so many resources out there. Obviously, my book's one of the so many resources. You know, there's the series of questions you can ask yourself to identify your beliefs and break them. You know, there's just so many resources online and everywhere that can help you with this. But just start with a goal or an ambition or a thing, something you'd like in terms of a person, what you'd like to be better at, become, you know, so this ties into your productivity thing. And then go, can I articulate a thing about what's stopping me doing that? Right. So, for example, with fitness, a lot of people go, yeah, I'd love to be fit, Steve, but I don't have the time. That's the classic one people use, right? Sure. Now, if I was to change your beliefs around that and say there is actually an exercise program where you only need to spend 12 minutes in the gym a week and you can be as fit as me, so you can challenge your beliefs, right? So identify something that's going to make you happy, decide what's stopping you doing that, and decide why you would believe that and what would be a great belief to replace it with.
That's fantastic. Steve, we'll put a link to the book in the show notes, make sure people get that, and also a link to the My Black Dog reference as well, because I think that's useful for people to have that. Steve, it's been an absolute joy hearing all your insights on beliefs, and I can highly recommend the book. I'm one of the fortunate few people to have seen it, because it's still yet to be published, and it's been published shortly. So when people watch this, it will be out in the bookshop. So thank you once again, and it's a joy spending time with you.
My pleasure, Michael. Thanks.
Thank you for tuning into this episode of the Peak Performance Productivity Podcast. Being a productive peak performer is about developing strong and long-lasting habits. Get your free habit installation kit from 5minutehabitkit.com right now, where you'll be able to permanently install any habit you choose in under 5 minutes a day with this proven 3-step system. They are surprisingly easy to install with this free kit once you know how. And if you've got just one thing from today's episode that you can use, then please like, share, subscribe, comment, or review to show your appreciation to today's guest. Until next time.